Today, I'm gonna show you everything you need to know in order to build your own subwoofer. And I'm also gonna incorporate a really cool piece of tech that I think is not only going to revolutionize the way people build subwoofers, but also speakers as well. This is my current subwoofer. And despite the fact that it looks like a custom unit, it's actually just a lightly modified and reskinned clips unit. I wanted to build my own subwoofer from the ground up for quite some time, but when I started looking into it, I realized that there is an absolute ton that you need to know. So I did a lot of research and I am going to attempt to distill all of that information down and make the whole process as easy as possible for you guys at home. So with all that being said, let's head to the shop and get started on this project. Oh, and did I mention that we're going bigger? Like way bigger. I hope my neighbors don't hate me at the end of this. When it comes to building a subwoofer, the very first thing you have to decide is which actual subwoofer driver you want to use, because every other decision will then flow from that. So for this project, I have selected this 12-inch reference series subwoofer from Dayton Audio. It's not the biggest, most powerful subwoofer in the world, but at 300 watts, it should be more than powerful enough for my home theater. Once you've got your subwoofer picked out, the next thing you need to worry about is the cabinet. And for our subwoofer today, we are going to start with, but not finish with, MDF. Oh. Do you want to build a ported or a sealed subwoofer? That's the first question you have to ask yourself before you start building your cabinet. Sealed subwoofers are punchier, have faster bass response time, and are generally preferred for music listening. They also have the advantage of being smaller. Ported subwoofers, on the other hand, are much more efficient, which means they get louder, and they have a more boomy and natural sound that extends deeper into lower frequencies. Usually, they're preferred for home theater use. And they also happen to be significantly larger, as you'll soon see, because today, we are building a ported sub. So I work my way down the cut list, one panel at a time. And you might be wondering how I already knew the size of all these parts. Well, I actually generated a complete 3D model of this project before I ever hit the shop. Using the optimal cabinet size listed on the subwoofer spec sheet, I dialed in the acoustics and answered questions like, where do I want the port to be located? Which is what we are currently cutting over on the CNC, along with an opening for the subwoofer itself. So here's the thing about the port. You can kind of think of it like a secondary driver. So because I plan to put the subwoofer against the wall and have it facing towards me, the front was the obvious choice. But depending on your own setup, you could also put it on the back, the side, or heck, even the top. And now that we're done cutting, here's what the front face of our subwoofer will look like. Well, kind of. We're gonna add some more elements too, but first we need to cut an opening for the amplifier. We'll go more in depth on the amp soon because it's a really important part of any sub, but for now we still have to cut a bunch of internal bracing for the cabinet. Now I know not everybody has a CNC like I do, but all of these cuts are also achievable using a jigsaw and a trim router. That being said, a CNC like this one does make things a lot easier and frees me up to do other work at the same time, like sketching the internal layout of the subwoofer to help guide me during assembly, which coincidentally is our next step now that the CNC is done cutting that bracing. The first thing I put together was the port runner, and this has a huge impact on the sound of your sub. This piece will sit inside the cabinet and defines the length of the port. And since it has a hard right angle that's going to be subject to wild swings in air pressure, I made these small little reinforcement brackets to help keep it from flexing during operation. While I was assembling the main cabinet, I was super thankful I had these large format corner clamps on hand. Not only did they hold everything together so my hands were free to operate the nail gun, but they also ensured that all of my joints were at perfect right angles, which is pretty important when you're building a box. So I'm going to put a link for them along with all the other tools and materials that I'll use throughout this project down in the video description. Now, let's talk about structure, because subwoofers, more than any other type of speaker, are subject to huge swings in internal pressure. As that front diaphragm moves in and out, it's pushing and pulling all of the air inside the cabinet, and at loud volumes, it can get quite violent. That's why this bracing is so important. It'll make sure that the walls of our cabinet don't flex during operation, which will improve sound quality and the longevity of our speaker. Now, before we finish the assembly, let's take a quick look at that port runner, because you are going to need to pick a tuning frequency. Now, I've opted for a relatively universal 32 hertz, but depending on the type of content you're primarily gonna be using it for, be it home theater use or music, you might wanna pick a different frequency. And the way you do that is by adjusting the total length of this port, or even more simply, by just changing the length of this piece here, 90% of cases. Now, as for which frequencies are best for which type of content, that's a whole internet audiophile rabbit hole that I don't want to go down right now, but it is definitely worth spending a little bit of time researching before you build your subwoofer. So now, before we add the last three walls to our subwoofer, while we still have good access to the internals, there's a couple things that I want to take care of. Internal resonance can destroy the sound quality of your speakers. That's why I got this stuff, cheap knockoff Dynamat. Basically, the problem is that as your speakers are operating, the cabinet itself can start vibrating, and those vibrations create their own interfering sound waves known as resonance. But by affixing these butyl rubber sheets, we can dampen, or in many cases, completely eliminate those vibrations. And the cool thing is, you don't even have to use that much. Covering a small fraction of the surface area is all you need to disrupt the vast majority of resonance. And it also makes the inside of the cabinet look really cool. Or at least it did temporarily. Because I realized that the inside of the port would be a huge pain in the ass to paint after assembly, so I decided to paint it beforehand. And then I got carried away and painted the entire inside of the sub, which might sound like a waste of paint and time, but here's the thing, raw MDF loves to absorb moisture, so by painting it and sealing it up, I'm actually prolonging the longevity of the speaker. And speaking of sealing, one important principle that I forgot to mention earlier is that you want your subwoofer's cabinet to be completely airtight. Well, except for the port, that is. But in order for the port to work properly, you can't be leaking air in other places. So when it came to glue and nails, I was happy to go a little overboard. Which did create some more work for me during the next step, where I made the outside of our box completely seamless. Using spackle, I filled all the nail holes and seams, waited for it to dry, and then sanded everything smooth. And it was at this point where I was struck by just how big the speaker was going to be.
Oh man, look at this thing. It is starting to look so cool. It's massive and I absolutely love it.
So now that we've got all of the filling done on it, let's paint this thing and then we can move on to covering up the MDF in an even better way. So just like on the inside, I painted the outside of the cabinet in the same flat black paint that I've used as an accent color on all of my other speakers. And now, having seen those speakers, I think you guys can probably tell where I'm going next.
All right, so while we wait for the paint to dry on the subwoofer, we are going to move on to the next stage of this project, where we are going to clad the subwoofer in something other than just black paint, because I don't want this thing to look like a boring black box. So in order to do that, we are going to use a little bit of walnut. That way we get the awesome acoustical properties of MDF, but we also get the look of a nice natural hardwood.
Unlike with my tower speaker project, I didn't want to use a thin wood veneer. Instead, for this project, I wanted some good chunky side panels, and that meant a good old-fashioned glue-up. I know I've cautioned you guys against using hardwoods for speakers in the past, but building the primary box out of MDF will allow me to laminate this wood onto the outside without worrying about its impact on sound quality. Plus, in this case, it'll allow for what I think is a pretty interesting design. After the glue dried, I did a bit of cleanup on my drum sander, squared up the outside edges with my track saw, and then fed both panels back into the CNC. Here, my plan is to recess the primary box into these side panels and create a kind of subwoofer sandwich. That way, I can still have the appearance of a thick sidewall without sacrificing nearly as much floor space. The only downside to this approach is that it was going to take a long time to carve. But lucky for you guys, we can just use a little bit of movie magic and skip right over it. Fresh off the CNC, I did a quick test fit to make sure I didn't screw anything up, and then over on the table saw, I cut down the remaining borders to a uniform 1.5 inches. And I actually picked this measurement for a specific reason, as you'll soon see. But first, I added a 45-degree chamfer for no reason other than I just kind of liked how it looked. After a quick sanding, and because consistency is important to me, I sealed the wood with the same polyurethane finish that I've used on all my other speakers. Finally, I was ready to install the panels, but I had a problem. I couldn't just screw the panels to the box from the outside because that would look horrible. So instead, I opted to screw them in place from the inside of the box, but I had to be careful to use the right length of screws, and I also had to be careful to not overdrive any of them. Thankfully, I managed to pull it off without a hitch, and at this point, the subwoofer was really starting to come together. But you might be looking at it and thinking, it's probably not such a good idea to have all of that weight resting on the thin, hard edges of those exterior panels. And you'd be right. That's why I got these vibration-absorbing feet that are specifically designed for subwoofers. Again, link in the video description. Earlier, I sized the overhangs on these side panels such that they'll hover just a millimeter or two off of the ground, while all of the weight is actually resting on these feet. It should all look pretty seamless back in my living room, but I'm getting ahead of myself because we still have to talk about the amp.
Now that we have our subwoofer cabinet all situated, one of the next things you're going to have to decide when building your own subwoofer is which amplifier to use. Or actually, you're gonna have to decide first whether or not you want to build a passive or a powered subwoofer. Now, a passive subwoofer is powered by an external source like an amplifier or an AV receiver, meaning that you are going to be supplying it with not just an audio signal, but also the power necessary to run the subwoofer. In our case, we are building a powered subwoofer, which means that it has its own internal power supply. So when you connect it to your home theater at home, the only thing that you have to supply it with is an audio signal. Now, this allows for better compatibility, potentially better audio quality, and in our case, a very neat trick that we are going to get to soon. But first, which amplifier do you pick? Well, in my case, I have a 300 watt Class D amplifier. Class D means that it's a digital amplifier, which in turn means that it's very efficient, compact, and doesn't generate a lot of waste heat. When it comes to picking the wattage of your amplifier, you want to match it as closely as possible to the power handling of your subwoofer without going over. If your amplifier is overpowered relative to your sub, you'll end up overdriving it, which is bad for sound quality, but will also probably end up destroying it pretty quickly. Oh, and one last thing, you want to make sure that the impedance of your sub is matched to the impedance of your amplifier. This is measured in ohms and should be pretty prominently displayed on either the packaging or the spec sheet. Now that we've gotten all of that out of the way, let me show you how you would install one of these guys in a more conventional setup, because mine's gonna be a little bit different.
Cutting our openings earlier means that we can dive right into wiring up the amp. Our subwoofer has spring style connectors, so the first thing I did was cut and strip both of the main leads. And you'll definitely want to do this before installation because removing the amp to do it later requires undoing all 12 mounting screws. Now that might seem like overkill, but there's actually a great reason for it. Like I said earlier, the sub needs to be airtight, so the amp actually seals against the cabinet with a gasket. Now, it turns out my wires were just barely long enough to reach, so that's definitely something you'll want to consider when sizing your cabinet. Again, the subwoofer also has a foam gasket, so I paid careful attention to not over-tighten all 8 of my brass mounting screws. And I chose brass not for any acoustic or structural reason, but just because I think it makes for a nice little accent on the front of the sub.
So at this point, this is a fully functional subwoofer and we could just plug it in my home theater and it would be good to go. But I promised you guys a game-changing feature that's going to be broadly applicable to all speaker systems and not just the subwoofer. So keeping that in mind, let's go back to my living room and I'll show you guys what I have in mind.
Oh my God, this thing is so heavy. I might die carrying it. I might actually die. Oh my God, okay.
And now, you can see just how much bigger this new sub is compared to the old one. If you've ever tried to run your own surround sound system at home, then you know how much of a pain in the ass it can be to run all of the wires. They're messy and getting them all concealed and nice looking is a lot of work. So because this is a powered subwoofer, I think I've actually found a way to allow it to communicate wirelessly with my AV receiver. This is a wireless transmitter and receiver from Dayton Audio. And the idea here is pretty simple. One side plugs into your AV receiver, one side plugs into your speaker. You supply it with a little bit of USB power and it allows the two to communicate wirelessly, thus eliminating a lot of clutter and also giving you the freedom to position the subwoofer wherever you want. But there's a problem. This looks pretty ugly and cobbled together to me, so I think with a little bit of ingenuity, we can make this look a lot better.
And this is exactly why I picked this particular amp. I knew that because it had an external USB port, that somewhere on its PCB, we'd be able to tap into a 5-volt power line and turn our external wireless receiver into an internal wireless receiver. With a bit of probing, I was able to isolate both a 5-volt pin and a ground where we can steal a bit of power. I double-checked my work, and then to keep those new wires from accidentally tearing off any pads or getting snagged on anything, I hot glued them in place. Next, we have to find a way to pipe the audio signal from the receiver into the amp internally, which sounds complicated at first, but it was actually just a matter of peeling off this black masking goo and then figuring out which traces are connected to the amp's RCA ports. Once I had it all uncovered, I probed for continuity, and bingo, I found them. But I also had a bit of a problem. Removing that black gunk did some damage to the PCB, and I was worried that over time that might allow for corrosion and potentially interference as well. So to fix that, I painted on a thick coating of an insulating solder mask. The only spots I left bare were the contacts where I'll make my audio input connections. But first, the mask had to cure, and this is actually a UV reactive coating, so I set it in the window to soak up some rays, and we'll come back to it in a minute. Because next, it was surgery time for our wireless receiver. And here, it was more or less the same process. I stripped it down to its bare PCB, did a bunch of diagnostic work to figure out which pins were responsible for power and which ones were responsible for the audio signal, soldered in some extension wires, and then stripped off any parts that I wasn't gonna need anymore. I was almost ready to install all this stuff back into the sub, but unfortunately, a new concern entered my brain. I've talked throughout this video about how the inside of the subwoofer can be a pretty active place, so I didn't want to just have a loose PCB floating around inside the cabinet. And this is why I love 3D printers. I quickly modeled the PCB in my favorite 3D modeling software, and then used that as the basis to design a custom mounting solution for it. 15 minutes later, I had a real, tangible, custom-made bracket in my hand and ready to install. To be able to go from concept to product in such a short amount of time is an absolute game changer for my DIY projects. So if you guys want to get started at home, I'm going to include a link down in the video description for some of my favorite 3D printers. With the solder mask cured, I made my last two connections, added some more glue to secure the wires, and headed back to the subwoofer to reinstall our brand new wireless enabled amplifier. To maximize reception and potentially minimize interference, I mounted the receiver on the topmost panel of the subwoofer. That way, it's got a nice straight shot for communicating with the wireless transmitter that I installed in my coffee table. This is the other half of the equation and connects to the subwoofer output on my AV receiver. And here's the really cool thing. This same process would work for any set of speakers, provided they aren't passive, of course. So I think over time, I'll slowly convert all of my speakers to be wireless.
All right, so now that we have everything all set up, what do you say we see how our new subwoofer sounds compared to a relatively expensive high-end store-bought one? Oh man, so compared to my old speaker, this new one feels a lot less punchy, but I mean that in a good way. Instead of having those big artificial bass hits where you're like, yeah, the bass is happening right now, this becomes more of like a whole room feeling. Not only are you hearing the sounds, but you're also feeling them in the air around you. And that makes a lot of sense given how much more air this big cone is moving, and also because of the front-facing port. So what you end up with is bass that fits a lot better in the mix and also feels a lot more realistic. Like watching Saving Private Ryan when they're landing on Normandy Beach, you really believe that those artillery shells are going off nearby. This also translates over really well to gaming, which honestly I wasn't really expecting, but I'm happy to be pleasantly surprised. And then when you're listening to music, it hits clean, articulate, and it just lays in the mix really, really well. In terms of volume, running this thing at like 50% is already getting to the point where I'm pretty sure my neighbors are gonna be banging on my front door. So if you want volume, yeah, this thing will get nice and loud. And then finally, one thing that I was really concerned about was latency and interference in the wireless transmission system. And here again, I'm happy to report that I haven't noticed any issues at all. Bass is probably the least likely sound frequency to be affected by latency. And also 2.4 gigahertz is known to be really quick. Plus, this system is specifically designed for sound transmission, so I guess it isn't any surprise that it works quite well. When it comes to interference, that's probably going to be more of a case-by-case basis and depend on what frequencies you have bouncing around your own home, but I'm happy to report that for me anyways, it's been rock solid. Overall, I think this thing is a huge improvement versus my old clip subwoofer, and I am really happy with how it turned out. I don't think I'll ever push it all the way to its limits in my current place, but it's good to know that I have that extra capacity in case I ever move into a place with a bigger home theater. Now, I do actually have quite a few thoughts of how I could have improved this project if I were to do it again, and I've actually compiled all of those into a separate bonus video that is available for channel members. So check that out if you're interested, and get all sorts of other bonus content like sneak peeks of upcoming projects. That's it for me, and I will see you guys in the next one. Peace.